Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Piketty. Thank you. Thank you for your very warm welcome. Let me first apologize for the fact that my English sounds a lot like French, and I hope this will be okay with you. Let me start by saying how honored and moved I am by being here today for this Nelson Mandela lecture. For everybody from my generation, from around the world, South Africa and Nelson Mandela, of course, have a universal meaning. So I was born in 1971, and when I was a teenager, South Africa was of course one of the very important countries that I was always hearing about. And when I became an adult in 1989, in Paris, we were commemorating the 200th anniversary of the French Revolution. But what was really important, what was going on, was elsewhere, was the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of apartheid with the liberation of Nelson Mandela in 1990 and the end of apartheid in the following years. And you know, being here today, 25 years later, is something which I find very, very moving and very strong, and I am very honored and grateful for the foundation, for inviting me. Of course, now that we are 25 years after the fall of apartheid, we are all puzzled by the fact that inequality not only is still very high in South Africa, but even in some way has been rising, and in some way income inequality is even higher today than 20 years ago, which is extremely puzzling for all of us, and this is something we want to better understand. And we also know from historical experience that extreme inequality of with the kind of level that we observe in South Africa is not good for development and growth, and it can also lead to violent reactions and violent events, and we all have in mind the very violent episodes in Maracana 3 years ago, and we know from historical experience that if inequality is not addressed through peaceful means and peaceful democratic institutions, it's always potentially a source of violence, and of course this can happen again. So what I really would like to do in this lecture is to try to see what we can learn from the historical experience of other countries with inequality in order to better analyze the future opportunities for a country like South Africa, but more generally for the world issue of inequality. So let me say right away, and I will speak more about this, that the fact that inequality today in some dimensions is higher in South Africa than what it was in 20 years ago in terms of concentration of income is partly due to international factors which are not completely, of course, under the control of the South African government. And I will come back to this later, and I think the international community, broadly speaking, has a big responsibility for the situation of inequality in South Africa, in Africa in general, and in the world in general, and some of the solutions will have to come from the international community. But that will not be enough just to blame the international factors, and I think there are also deeper reasons for the fact that in terms of reduction of inequality, the South African revolution, so to speak, did not deliver as much as one might have expected. And generally speaking, I would say the general reason is that equality in formal rights and in basic civil rights, even though it is of course very important, the right to move in the country, the right to take all possible occupation, at least in theory, the right to vote, all these formal civil rights are extremely important, but equality in formal rights is not sufficient to reach real equality. So if you want effective rights to move. It's not enough to be formally allowed to go to the other part of the country. If you cannot pay rent or housing to go where the jobs are, in effect, the right to move remains a limited, very limited right. And more generally, I will argue that we now need to think harder about how to secure effective rights, including right to work for a decent wage, right to good quality education, right to access to property, and finally, and maybe most importantly, right to real economic and political democracy, including sharing of economic power in companies and participatory governments, both in the public and the private sector. So in this presentation, I'm going to make three different points. You know, in the first part, I will first try to put the issue of inequality into an historical perspective and see what we can learn from historical experiences with reduction of inequality in different countries. Then, in the second point will be about the solution for reducing inequality in South Africa that we can draw from historical experience. And then the third part of the lecture will be about the global response to inequality and the need for international action. So let me first start with history and the historical perspective. I think it's important because there's a lot of historical amnesia in the world sometimes about inequality, and I think it's important to take this broad historical and comparative perspective. And As a scholar, as an academic, my work has been primarily the work of an historian trying to collect historical data on inequality and wealth. I should stress that this was possible only through a very collective research project. So I started working on the inequality of income and wealth in France about 15 years ago, but then I was very fortunate to find many collaborators in many countries, Tony Atkinson on Britain, who also worked on the case of South Africa, Emmanuel Saez on the US, who also worked on Japan and Canada, Facundo Alvaredo on Argentina and Chile and Mexico, Abhijit Banerjee on India, and I cannot make the complete list, but it's really a very international, global collective research program that is now continuing. I should stress that we still know too little about inequality, and we know a little bit more than we used to, and I will try to share some of the lessons that we have learned, but we still know too little. We are in the social sciences. There are different ways to interpret history, and our objective is not to come with ready to apply solution or magic bullet, but rather to contribute to a more informed democratic discussion about inequality. And ultimately, the objective is really that everybody, normal citizen, can look at this data, look at the book written from this data, and make their own opinion, because these issues are too important to be left to a small group of experts. And I think, it's wrong to believe. Sometimes economists like to pretend that they have built an economic science that is so sophisticated that the rest of the world cannot understand. But of course, this is a big joke. But what's important is not to let economists do that. I think it's important to realize that issues of inequality, income, wealth, capital, public debt are not technical issues. These are issues on which everybody must have an opinion, because ultimately this is what determines political change. So if we look at this historical database that we have collected, probably the most important finding is that we cannot simply rely on market forces and trickle-down mechanism in order to deliver the right level of inequality. And so this very optimistic theory of economic development, which at some point was described as the theory of the Kuznets curve, according to which you have a natural reduction of inequality in advanced stages of development, well, this theory is just wrong if you take this very broad international perspectives that we have taken in our research. In particular, one very important findings is that if you look at the reduction of inequalities that happened during the first half of the 20th century in North America, in Europe, or in Asia, you can see that this has nothing to do with a natural process based on market forces. It is due to a large extent to the very violent shocks of World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, and most importantly, to the new policies, the new social policies, welfare state policies, the new fiscal policies, progressive taxation, that were finally accepted by the elites after these violent shocks and also after the Bolshevik Revolution, which put strong pressures on the elites in Western countries to accept reforms which until 1914, until World War I, were refused. Now, that's a very important lesson. In particular, this is particularly striking for my own country, France, to see that until 1914, until World War I, you actually have rising concentration of wealth, and with a level of concentration of wealth which was probably, if anything, higher than a century before or 130 years before under the ancien regime, under the French Revolution. And that's very striking for several reasons. First, because at that time, in 1910, 1900, 1914, the French Republican elite, financial, economic, and political elite, were very strongly in a very strong denial of this. And basically, they were saying, well, no, this cannot be possible because we have made the French Revolution. So this is enough. You know, we are now a country of equals. We don't have aristocrats anymore. We have equal formal rights. We have the right to move, the right to take any occupation, the right to property, the right to vote, at least for men at that time. And therefore, we are a country of equals. So, for instance, we don't need progressive taxation. And it's very interesting to see that France, you know, France sometimes likes to portray itself as a country of equality. But, you know, there's always a lot of hypocrisy in all these kind of statements about a country of equality, country of opportunity. And, you know, the elites have a lot of imagination for self-serving statements and in order to justify the system from which they benefit. So in the end, France was actually the last country to create an income tax in the summer of 1914. And this was not to pay for education or for schools. This was to pay to war with Germany. Okay? And other countries had already created the income tax before, the US in 1913, Britain in 1908, Prussia, Japan, Sweden in 1880, 1890. France was the very last one among developed countries to create an income tax. What's interesting is to understand why. It's because there was this feeling among the elite that, well, we have done the French Revolution, we don't have aristocrats, we are a country of equals, so we don't need progressive taxation. Britain, of course, will need progressive taxation because they have all this aristocracy with this queen and this concentrated land, so they should create progressive tax right away. But in France, we don't need it because we've done the French Revolution. So that's interesting, first, for historical reasons, but also because we can see that, you know, the elites have a lot of imagination to justify their position. It's also interesting because this failure of the French Revolution, which is sort of the bourgeois revolution par excellence, which gave equal rights, you know, before 1789, before the French Revolution, a small group of aristocrats, which were about 1% of the population, had a very privileged right regarding the fiscal system, regarding political right. There were also restrictions to mobility within the country and to the kind of occupation you can take depending on your social origins. So, you know, there were privileges in the country. And at that time, the hope during the French Revolution is that if we have equal rights to take all occupation, to move, equal right to property, then this should be enough to bring a country of equals. And the fact that it didn't work this way, and that, in fact, over the course of the 19th century and in the early 20th century, we get to a concentration of wealth that is, in some ways, even higher than under the ancien regime, is very interesting because it shows one of the deep reasons that I try to explain in my research is that the fact of being a republic rather than a monarchy. You know, I'm very happy to be in a republic, by the way, but the fact of being in a republic rather than a monarchy doesn't really change the deep economic mechanisms through which the concentration of wealth is working. And in particular, the fact that all over the 19th century, you have a rate of return to capital that is markedly higher than the growth rate of the economy, 4-5%, 6% per year for the new capital investment in the manufacturing sector as compared to a growth rate of 1-2% per year. Well, this gap between the two can explain to a large extent why we continue with a very large concentration of wealth until World War I. So it's only very violent shocks which occurred in the 20th century, which finally convince the elite to accept a number of fiscal and social reforms that were not adopted before. Now, I think this is of interest to South Africa because, you know, of course, I don't want to compare the French Revolution and the South African Revolution. It's a completely different context. And in a way, you know, the inequality regime that existed under apartheid was much more oppressive and violent than ancien regime in France. The group that had more rights than the rest of the population, namely the whites, was much bigger. You know, it was not 1% of the population, it was 10-15%. So that's you know, it's more difficult to deal with a situation like this than with 1%. The difference in color of skin is also important because when everybody is white in France, you can sort of forget a couple of generations later who comes from what group, which is more difficult with the color of skin. No, but it's a trivial remark, but it makes a big difference in the long run in order to move ahead and solve this kind of situation. And finally, the repression of basic rights, which was happening under apartheid, was much more violent with restrictions to mobility, and we had a reference to this, and expulsion, and the very strong territorial discrimination, which did not really exist in France in the 18th century, and which in some ways looked more like the kind of serfdom systems that we had a couple of centuries before. So, you know, the challenges, the system from which South Africa comes from is, in a way, a much more oppressive inequality system than France under the ancien regime. And that's another reason why formal equal rights is not sufficient to bring equality. So one of the lessons I draw from this historical part of my lecture is that we need more than formal equal rights, rights to move, rights to take occupation. That's important, but that's not enough. So let me now turn to the issue of inequality in South Africa today and what kind of response to reduce inequality we can think of. First, what do we know about the level of inequality in South Africa, how this has changed since the fall of apartheid, and how does this compare to other countries? We know too little, you know, in particular regarding wealth concentration, but everything we know suggests an unusually high level of inequality, higher than what we observe pretty much everywhere else in the world. So just to take one number, which I find particularly striking, if we use the South African income tax data together with national accounts, household survey, and we do the same for other countries, we find that the share of total income going to the top 10% income earners in South Africa currently, right now, is between 60 and 65% of total income for the top 10%. Just to make comparison, in Brazil, using similar data, we are between 50 and 55%. In the US, we are between 45 and 50%. And in most European countries, we are between 30 and 35%. So with 60 to 65, just to remember these orders of magnitude, South Africa is really at the top of the class, so to speak, and is in a way way out other experience that we can see of. Now, if we try to explain this, you know, some people say, well, that's because we have very high unemployment. And certainly, high unemployment is a big, big problem to solve and to address in South Africa. But I don't think this can explain, I think, this extremely and unusually high level of inequality. I think unemployment is more a symptom of inequality, unequal skills, unequal distribution across the territories where people cannot move to where the jobs are and have not access to the right skills. But this in itself cannot explain such a high level of income concentration. Just to take an example, there are other countries in the world, unfortunately, where you have very high unemployment. You know, in Spain or Greece, you have also 25% rate of unemployment. Level of income inequality. You still have 30 to 35% of total income to the top 10% as compared to 60 to 65% in South Africa. So even if the data is not perfect, I think it's very clear that the extreme level of inequality that we have in South Africa is much more than just unemployment. It has to do certainly with the legacy of the apartheid. In particular, it is striking to see that what's really different in South Africa as compared to other countries is the top 10% share. you take the top 1% share, it's not so different from the US today, but if you take the top 10% share, then it's really higher in South Africa. So this really suggests that what's specific is that you have a relatively large group in the country, around 10%, which is very far away from the rest of the population. And of course, this group historically has been predominantly or almost exclusively white, and even today, if you look at the data we have to within, especially within the top 5% or top 1%, it will be up to 80% white. So things have changed a little bit, but we are still very much with this same structure of racial inequality that we used to have. So now, how can we make progress? So let me make clear that I am not, you know, I'm not here to give lessons to South Africa. I'm trying to see what we can learn from historical experience. Certainly, the international context has played a role in rising inequality in South Africa since the 1990s. Let me mention a number of reasons. You know, the certainly financial deregulation, which has happened over in the world in the past 25 years, has contributed to rising inequality. More generally, the fall of communism around 1990 has opened the way for a new era of unlimited faith in self-regulated markets, and in some cases this has clearly gone too far. Financial deregulation is one example, and this has contributed to the rise of financial fragility, and which eventually has contributed to the financial crisis of 2008. More generally, if you have globalization without proper regulation, globalization in itself can be a powerful force to reduce inequality at the world level. But if you don't have proper regulation at the same time, in particular regarding taxation, this can contribute to rising inequality. Also, rising commodity price, of course, has contributed to rising top income shares in South Africa. But it will not be enough just to blame these international factors. I think there are really domestic solutions to the inequality in South Africa. So, as I already said, I think there are at least four areas of rights where we need to turn to a policy of effective rights. Rights to labor, work for a decent wage, right to high-quality education, right to access to property, and right to economic and political democracy. So let me just say a bit more about these four rights. Regarding right to work for a decent wage, I think the discussion that South Africa is having right now about the introduction of a national minimum wage is extremely important. And I think that from the historical and comparative experience we have, in my view, if we are able to find the right level for the national minimum wage, then definitely South Africa could and should introduce a national minimum wage. There are countries in the world, not only in the rich world, but also emerging countries like Brazil, who have a national minimum wage. We were able to find the right level for the national minimum wage, although these are much bigger countries than South Africa, 200 million inhabitants, a lot of geographical disparity, and I think South Africa should be able to find the right level for the national minimum wage, and this is a way to avoid situation of extreme exploitation of low-skilled workers, particularly in areas where they have limited opportunity to move. Now, this in itself is not going to solve the key problem, which is the inability to access higher paying jobs. And so here the second important effective right that needs to be strengthened is the right to high quality education, together with the right with adequate public infrastructure, including transportation infrastructure. So regarding public education, I think it is fair to say that the quality of public primary education and junior secondary education that is available to the most disadvantaged group in this country is not satisfactory, and that this should be a national priority, and a lot of progress could be made in this direction. So I understand that many people, in particular many business leaders that I have met in recent days, are, you know, are very skeptical about the capacity of the government to deliver this. But on the other hand, I think there's no other option than to try to improve the functioning and to contribute to pay the tax that we need in order to finance this public sector of education. You know, there's no other strategy. The strategy according to which, you know, we could do it through privatizing the education system, the health system, and let the business sector do it, I think it will not work. I think what has worked in history in order to have sustainable and equitable growth is to have a well-functioning public education and health system, and South Africa should go in this direction. The third effective right which I want to stress is the right to access to property. So that's probably one of the more complicated rights because, of course, it involves very difficult and sensitive issues, including land reform. Let me just say that if we take a broad international historical perspective, we see in many countries in history much more ambitious land reforms than what we have seen in South Africa since the end of the apartheid. I think it's fair to say, or at least many observers have noted, that the black economic empowerment strategies, which were mostly based on voluntary market transactions at market values, were not that successful at spreading the wealth and at limiting the extreme concentration of wealth from which we start in South Africa. So I think we need to think again about more ambitious land reform. I also think that, like many other countries, but maybe probably even more than other countries, South Africa will benefit from increased transparency about wealth and about who owns what in South Africa. And I think it is very difficult to have a reasonable democratic conversation about wealth with so little information. So in particular, people talk about BEE policy and their impact, but in fact, there's really very little data on wealth. That's partly because access to the estate tax data is extremely difficult, to say the least, in South Africa. So there is an estate tax, but it's very difficult to know how many taxpayers transmitted wealth between 1 million, 2 million rands, 10 million, 20 million rands year after year. And most importantly, even if this data was available, this would be only information about wealth at death, and, you know, wealth of the living is even more interesting than wealth at death in a way, and I think it will be important and absolutely possible for South Africa to introduce an annual tax on net wealth, a progressive annual tax on net individual wealth, even if it comes with very low tax rate to begin with, say, you know, 0% below 1 million rands in wealth, 0.1% between 1 and 10 million, and 0.5% above 10 million. You know, I'm just putting numbers so that people have an idea. I think even with relatively low tax rates such as this one, the big advantage of an annual tax on wealth is that it will produce democratic transparency about wealth, and we would know more about who owns what in South Africa and how this is changing over time. And I think it's very important in a country to be able to look year after year at how the different social groups and the different wealth groups are doing and how they are benefiting or not benefiting from growth and development. And if we don't have this kind of public information, then, you know, this is what gives away to very extreme statements from one way or another, from both sides, and it makes it very difficult to come to reasonable and peaceful solutions. So I think, you know, I understand that, you know, many people in the business community might be against that, but, you know, in the end, in the long run, I think it's in the interest of the business community to promote transparency about wealth, because if we don't have... You know, if you refuse transparency, it must be that there's something to hide. So, you know, that's not good. In order to build trust in a country, I think it's very important to have that kind of transparency about income and wealth dynamics. And finally, the last and fourth effective right, which I would like to stress, has to do with economic and political democracy. I think it's important in South Africa, like in other countries in the world, to have a new discussion about worker participation in companies, participatory governance. There are many countries in the world, including countries that are doing very well in terms of economic efficiency and export and competitiveness, like Sweden and Germany, where workers have a strong power in the board of companies. So in Sweden, you have one third of the seats in board of companies that go to worker. In Germany, it's up to one half. And, you know, apparently this does not prevent them from producing good products and exporting all over the world. So, you know, in my country, in France, for a long time, employers and business people were completely against it. Well, they are still against it, but the difference is that 2 years ago, there was a law saying, okay, now there's going to be one employee representative out of 12 board members, so that's much less than in Sweden than in Germany. But because, you know, everybody was telling employers in France, was, look, this is what they do in Germany, and you know, German firms are doing better than French firms, so why you don't want workers on board? In the end, maybe it's a way to involve workers in the strategy of the company. So instead of just fighting, you know, you can have effective discussion about the strategy of the company, and sometimes this can also be a way to promote more long-run strategy than just short-term maximization of profits. Now, let me turn to the third and final part of this lecture, which has to do with the global response to inequality, because I think it's clear that, you know, South Africa cannot solve all inequality problems in the world alone, and there are many issues for which the rich countries, in particular countries in the north, have a huge responsibility, in particular in order to promote global financial transparency and fight against tax havens. And more generally, it is clear that countries in the north have a huge historical responsibility for inequality in the world today and poverty in many southern countries. Europe has a direct responsibility for the existence of the apartheid in the first place, and more generally, the apartheid system was simply one extreme version of a form of colonial inequality structure that you see in French colonies, in British colonies, all across colonial history. So, you know, the French Revolution, again, was very strong in terms of abstract principles. You know, Article 1 of the Declaration of Rights of 1789 was saying that all men should have equal rights, that social distinction should be based only on common utility. But in practice, the French Republic went on to develop, you know, one of the worst colonial empires in history. And you know, the French revolutionary said in 1792 that they wanted to abolish slavery, but then the government of France under Napoleon and under the monarchies reinstated slavery, which was finally abolished in 1848. And when Haiti took seriously the French Revolution and decided that they would be independent and decided to be independent in 1804. As you probably know, you know, what happened is that not only France was very unhappy, but France said in the end, in 1825, okay, you're going to be independent, but you're going to pay the price for this. And there's going to be a large compensation to the slave owners, to us, for you being free. So what happened is that there was this very large public debt that was imposed on Haiti, which Haiti had to reimburse until the middle of the 20th century. And all along the 19th century, Haiti is paying interest payment to France as a compensation for the fact that the slave owners are not getting income from their slaves. And, you know, there is so much historical amnesia. You know, we forget about these things, and when Haiti started to ask for compensation again a few years ago, you know, in 2004, and when they were commemorating the 200th anniversary, the French government said, okay, we won't go to Haiti for the anniversary because we don't want to hear about this compensation. So, you know, this is just an example to say that, you know, historical amnesia and the responsibility of northern countries in today's inequality situation in the world is enormous. Now, if we look at the future, because, you know, just talking about the past is not enough, although in this case, I think it is still time for compensation and for reimbursing the debt that was paid from Haiti to France. But if we look at the future and from a more global perspective, I think, you know, it is clear that Europe and North America have a strong responsibility if we want to encourage financial transparency in the world. And, you know, I think Europe and North America should stop having a double language with Africa, which is that on the one hand, they always give lessons about good governance and transparency, etc., and on the other hand, their own multinational companies and their own wealthy citizens are the very ones who are benefiting from financial opacity, and they are nothing at all about it. They are doing nothing at all about it. So there's really a double language, which I think is absolutely terrible. I think, you know, what Africa needs is not foreign aid. You know, Africa is not asking for help. What Africa needs is to have an international legal system that allows African countries to make multinational companies and wealthy citizens pay their fair tax. And this is what Europe and North America should now offer. So I think there are at least two concrete proposals that you know, the northern countries should make substantial progress. First one is that there should be a lot more transparency about how much multinational companies from Europe and North America are paying in tax when they are doing business in Africa. And so The European Parliament sort of voted a text about this 2 years ago, but it's not sufficient information disclosure. And in addition, the information is actually very difficult to access. So, you know, it's a very strange system where the companies are supposed to disclose information, but in the end, it's so well hidden in remote reports that are not accessible freely online that nobody can get the information. And in any case, the requirements that were made in terms of information disclosure were completely insufficient to compute what we would like to compute in order to impose better behavior on this company. Now, the second proposal, which I think is even more important, is that Europe and North America should accept the creation of a world financial register on financial assets, which will be a central repository for financial assets so that we will know who owns what financial assets all across the world. Now, some of you might react by saying, oh, but this is completely utopian. How could we do that? Well, let me tell you that, in fact, we already have this kind of central repository for assets, because that's useful for private companies to know who owns them. You know, now you don't have paper titles for a long time, so it's all electronic titles, and you need someone to keep track of who owns what in the world. Otherwise, you could have different people who claim that they own the same company, which will create a number of problems. So you have central repository who keep this information, but these are private institutions. These are not public institutions. So they are called Clearstream or Eurostream in Europe. They are called National Depository Trust Corporation in the US. So these are private corporations who are offering these services to financial companies so that they keep track of who owns them. But these private institutions do not collaborate with the public institution, and in particular do not send their information to tax administration. So I think it is time that governments in Europe and North America in particular, but all across the world, take control of this private depository institution and create a public world registry of financial assets. I think, you know, first, that will be useful also for financial regulation. You know, when we try to monitor a world financial crisis and nobody has any idea of who owns what in the world, you know, this creates problems also just for macroeconomic policy and basic financial regulation. But most importantly, this will be important for taxation policy, because this would This is what would allow the different countries to better know who owns what in their own country and to impose minimal taxation. Now, this is possible. In particular, the European Union and the United States are about to negotiate a new transatlantic treaty to reduce tax on trade. But, you know, the bottom line is that there's no tax on trade anymore. So there's not much to do in this treaty. And that will be a unique opportunity to tell to the world, okay, now we're really going to be serious to fight tax havens. And that will be very important for everybody in the world, but particularly for Africa, because if we take the existing estimates of what fraction of the world financial assets are held in tax havens, then the fraction is much bigger in African countries or for the Middle East than it is for Europe or in France. The best estimates we have for Africa is that between 30 and 50% of financial wealth is held offshore. So clearly, this is in effect a way to take away from Africa some of the resources that are necessary for development. So again, just to conclude, I don't think what needs Africa is a new form of foreign aid, which in any case, you know, aid flows. Let me also remind to you this basic fact, which is that all aid flows going to Africa are less than the official outgoing profit flows going out of Africa and that are paid to owners, in particular in Europe and North America. Now, these are the official flows. Okay? So if we think of the unofficial flows going to tax havens, again, the estimates we have are that these are at least of the same order of magnitude, so the total will be vastly larger than the, at least twice as large than the aid flow. So again, what we need really for the future is not so much to talk about aid, but simply to change the international legal system so that African governments can conduct a tax policy without being always threatened sometimes by their own business community to go away and not contribute to the common good. And, you know, I understand some people today are saying, okay, but, you know, we could just organize the system through voluntary donation and charitable giving. And, you know, I understand that people who have a lot of money would like just to decide how much they want to contribute to such or such project, but, you know, it's very difficult to organize a society like this. It's very difficult to organize a society where thousands of people just want to decide for themselves how much they want to contribute to the public good. So we need a legal system, in particular an international legal system that allows African countries to develop a fair tax system that's asking to those at the top, at least as much as those in the middle and at the bottom, which is not the case as of today. Let me now, as a general conclusion, you know, try to be optimistic about the future. You know, I said, you know, there are big challenges ahead, but there are solutions, and there are peaceful solutions to address inequality. Let me be also optimistic about South Africa and Africa. I was making this comparison with the South African Revolution, the French Revolution. South Africa and France have a lot in common. In a way, today they almost have the same size. You know, the population of France is 60 million. The population of South Africa is 55 million. So it's, you know, almost the same size. But a big difference is that France has had a stagnation of population for a very long time. So the population of France was already 40 million a century ago and 30 million at the time of the French Revolution. So, you know, it's almost the same country, almost the same families, almost the same. Whereas South Africa has gone through an enormous population growth and it's a very young and dynamic and energetic country. And South Africa in 1910, at the time of the creation of the South African Union, had 6 million inhabitants, including 5 million black and colored and 1 million white. And now we have gone from 10 to 55 with 5 white and 50 blacks and colored. So this is not the same country. This is when you multiply the size of a country by 10, and the population as of 1980, in the early 80s, was around 30 million. So the country has gone from 30 to 55. Now, these are enormous challenges. So when we talk about public infrastructure, public education, you know, it's difficult to keep up with this. It's difficult, but in the long run, I think this is an asset. I think the youth of South Africa and the energy of the population of South Africa is an asset. I think it's better to have positive population growth, well, maybe not enormous population growth, but positive rather than negative population growth. And, you know, when I see Africa, you know, European countries who have negative population growth, I think, you know, for the future, that's very frightening in terms of inequality and in terms of just what these countries are going to become with the aging. And, you know, some countries like France are doing now a bit more children than others like Germany. Germany is a bit more open to migrants recently. But then you have many countries in Eastern Europe, you know, they don't want children and they don't want migrants either. So, you know, they're going to disappear. And now South Africa and Africa are not going to disappear. And I think if these challenges that we have referred to today are addressed adequately, you know, I think Africa and South Africa are the future of the world. And so let me conclude this. And thanks a lot for your attention.